Stand that white line, please. Your name is Anne Margaret Griffin, is that correct?
Yes.
You've been charged with armed robbery. You'll be held on remand until your trial.
It's all a dreadful mistake. I tried to tell the police, but they wouldn't listen to me. I didn't steal any money. It was given to me by my friend. The woman in the shop said I threatened her with a carving knife. It wasn't me. It couldn't have been.
Look, you'll have a chance to explain all that at your trial. Now, expecting bail to be forthcoming?
Well, only if they can find Megan. I haven't anyone else.
Well, we've been to the address you gave us for this Megan Evans, but there was no one home. Now, we've been back several times, and it's always deserted.
Oh, that's right. She said she was going to go away for a holiday.
I see. Do you know where?
To Surfer's Paradise, I think. Yes, I'm sure she said that's where she was going.
Well, do you know the address where she's staying?
No, it was with a friend. I know she lives somewhere near the beach.
Well, that's not very much help, I'm afraid. You don't know the friend's name?
No.
Oh, well, I think we'll have to get the Surfers Paradise police to see if they can locate Megan Evans. Unfortunately, everything you've told us so far has been pretty vague. We haven't got much to go on.
And there isn't anything else to tell you.
You think this Megan Evans will be able to confirm everything you've told us so far?
Yes, of course she will. Please find her quickly.
Well, we'll do our best, Miss Griffin. What have we got here?
This is Anne Griffin.
Hi.
Hiya. Hi. I'd like you to show her the ropes.
Oh, yeah. First thing we better do is get you some food.
Oh, no, thanks. I'm not hungry.
Well, you've got to eat.
No, I couldn't, honestly.
I don't blame you. I can't eat this myself. Not as good as Mother used to make it. She was a lousy cook.
Well, come on. Sit down anyway. This here is Lizzie.
Hello.
And Judy.
Hi.
And B. And B's in charge round here.
The governor's in charge round here, Doreen.
Oh, you know what I mean, Mrs. Jackson.
What are you in for, Anne?
Oh, it's all a mistake.
Oh, yeah, we all make mistakes. I killed two people. That's a mistake I made that got me in here.
I've had a bit of a run of bad luck. I've lost my job, and while I was waiting for the dole, the landlady threatened to throw me out of the house. She was really nasty.
Sounds like old Vinegar's opened a boarding house on the outside.
Yeah, just like her style.
Go on, Anne.
Well, I didn't know what I was going to do, and then my friend Megan gave me some money.
Oh, you're lucky to have a good friend to help you.
Oh, yes, she's always helping me. She's my best friend.
Well, if she's your best friend, how come you ended up in here?
The police came. They said I'd held up a shopkeeper with a carving knife and taken some money from it. And when they found the money that Megan had given me, they said it was from the robbery. They arrested me.
Oh, but that's not much evidence for them to go on.
The lady from the shop identified me in a lineup.
Oh, well, you're going at me in there.
I know. But it wasn't me. She made a mistake. I told the police all about Megan, but they didn't seem to believe me.
Well, why doesn't your friend come forward and tell him yourself?
She's away on holidays.
Oh.
Until they find her, I'll have to stay in here. You remind me of Megan. She always looks after me.
Well, she wasn't exactly there when you needed her. Have you known her a long time?
Oh, yes, for years. I really love her. She's... Oh, she's much more attractive than I am, and she's not scared of anyone. She knows how to handle people and get what she wants.
Oh, she sounds like a good friend to have.
Yes, she is. I wish you could meet her.
Well, maybe one day I will. Let's hope it's not in this joint, eh?
You're very nice, Judy. I'm glad I've met you.
Thanks. Well, time for us to get locked up in our cages. Better go back to mine, huh? We'll see you in the morning.
Sometimes I wish I could go to sleep and never wake up again.
Hey, we'll have no more of that kind of talk. Now, don't you worry, Anne. You're going to be okay. Good night.
You understand? Not unless I say so. Now, just leave me a bit of peace and quiet. I want to have a think about it.
Why does everyone always do what she says?
Because she's the boss, that's why.
The boss?
Yeah, you know, somebody's got to be the boss.
Yeah, that's right, love. Bea always knows what's best. That's why everyone takes notes of her.
Besides, if you don't, she'll thump you.
Yeah, so if you just do as she says, you'll be all right.
Hello. I'll call you when I'm ready. I'm Andrew Potter. I'm from Legal Aid.
But I haven't got any money.
That's what Legal Aid is about. Do sit down. Now, first of all, bail. There's no one that could stand surety for you.
No.
What about this Megan?
Oh, she's away on holidays.
It's a serious offence, Anne.
I didn't do it.
So we've got a few things in our favour. The evidence is circumstantial. As it turns out, the shopkeeper admits she didn't get a good look at the thief.
I had never even seen her before they arrested me.
So the case against you relies largely on the fact that you were found near the scene with the exact amount of money stolen.
I've told them. Megan gave it to me.
But unless we can find Megan, we've only got your word for that.
Well, how am I expected to find her? I'm in jail. Well, I saw her off on the plane. She was upset. I don't know why. We had some coffee and I tried to find out what was wrong with her. She told me that she just needed a break. I said I didn't believe her. She was going to tell me. I know she was going to tell me. And then that voice came over the loudspeaker and she said that was her flight and she'd have to go. She just left half of her coffee and went down the escalator, and that was the last I saw of her.
And I'm afraid that unless the police can find her, we're going to have a little trouble proving your innocence.
Thought I might find you in here.
Hi.
How come you're not in the rec room with the others?
Trying to learn my lines for the panto. Anyway, things are a bit confused down there with all that money going off, so I thought I'd let Bede sort it out herself.
Yeah, she really likes to think she's boss, doesn't she?
Oh, well, she is boss, honey. Don't get confused about that.
I know people aren't supposed to ask, and, well, if you don't want to tell me...
You want to know how I got in here, huh? I guess you could say that I committed myself. That'd be the word for it. See, I had a friend I really cared a lot about, and she was in here, so I got busted to be with her.
Was that Sharon, the one who...
Yes, that was Sharon. Do you know a screw killed her? Anyway, after she died, I broke out. Didn't work out, though. You have to have a lot of money for that sort of thing and plan everything step by step.
Sounds like you're thinking about it again.
Me? No. Well, not at the moment, anyway.
Why not?
No reason.
It's a pretty bad kind of a place.
Oh, it's not too bad, I guess. It's better than being on the run, isn't it? How about you? How are you finding it?
Oh, it's a bit scary. Since Sharon, has there been anyone?
Why?
You must get very lonely.
Well, there was someone I liked. Hey, have you been there, have you?
Mm-hmm. This girl, well, she was really beautiful. Oh, not beautiful like a film star or anybody, but interesting. High cheekbones and these really amazing eyes. She could look right into you. She'd just broken up with someone. I'd always been straight until then, but it was strange. As soon as I saw her, I just knew. She held out a hand.
Is that Megan?
No, her name was Eloise.
Oh, well, what's Megan?
Oh, she's just my friend.
Well, Anne, I like you very much, you know that, but not in that way, huh?
Why not?
No reason. Just the way I am at the moment, okay?
We'll be recommending that your prosecution for theft begins as soon as possible.
Robbery with violence is too serious an offence for you to expect anything less than a jail sentence.
But Mr. Potter said he thought I could get off.
That was when he expected Megan Evans to give evidence. Unfortunately, there's no trace of her.
Don't my family know where she is?
They've, never heard of her.
Oh, that's impossible.
Miss Griffin, I'm only telling you what your brother told me. The only Megan they've ever heard of is...
They want me to go to jail. That's it, isn't it? That's why you're here. You're not trying to get me off. You want to get me locked up and safely out of the way.
Miss Griffin, I assure you, your brother is only trying to help.
Liar! He just wants to keep all the money for himself. He's never wanted me to have any.
Miss Griffin...
Liar!
Is everything all right, Mr. Collins?
Yes, thank you. Sit down, please, Anne.
Call me if you need me. I'll be right outside.
Thank you. As I was saying, the only Megan your brother knew was your daughter. And you know she's been dead for several years.
Well, come on, love. Throw it in. The wet clothes. Throw them in the dryer.
Couldn't. I'd suffocate her.
She's not in there now. Good. She'd be a bit on the nose if she was.
They thought I was lying.
And were you?
No, I told them that I saw her, but I didn't tell them it was Megan. They don't even believe that she exists.
Do you really reckon that you saw your friend in there?
Well, that's why she can't help me. If she knew I was in trouble, she'd tell the police that they've got the wrong person. If she isn't dead, why doesn't she come and help me?
How do you think she got in here and in the laundry?
I don't know. You don't believe me either, do you?
Sure,
I'm telling you that Megan's dead. I found her. When I went into the bedroom, she was in the cot. She wasn't breathing. The doctor didn't know why. He said it was a cot death.
Anne, who are you talking about?
Well, my baby, Megan.
But you told us that your husband took her away. How many kids have you got?
Oh, I didn't tell you that. She was all I had. Now she's dead. I named her after my friend, Megan. Now she's dead too. That's why she can't help me.
If I say there are no escape plans, you had better believe it. But if you don't, I'm liable to get very nasty.
Don't do this. Don't do that or you'll be locked in your room. Don't cry enough, child, anymore. Sit up straight. Remember who you are. Be a lady. Don't speak back to me. You do as you're told. Damn you! I won't! I won't! You're always setting the rules. Well, I won't let you. You're not going to tell me what to do anymore. You'll make me hurt you like the last time.
You're on the cover me from behind. I should wring your neck.
No, please. No, don't hurt me. Don't punish me. I wouldn't hurt anyone, I promise.
You ever touch me again and I won't think twice about killing you.
Won't. I know too much. But you can trust me. We're friends, aren't we?
You know, if there's anything worrying you, you can always go to Mrs. Davidson.
Oh, why should anything be worrying me?
I know about that letter from your family. Now, if you'd like us to try and contact them and explain...
No, they didn't mean what they said. They're just punishing me, that's all. As soon as my trial's over and they know I'm innocent, they'll have me back.
What do you mean by punishing you?
Oh, they're just strict, that's all. I don't like to be embarrassed. But it'll be all right as soon as they know I'm innocent. I've told the police I don't need any money. My family's rich. Why would I want to rob anyone? And I could never threaten anyone with a knife. I hate knives.
Well, without Megan to testify, it could be very difficult to prove.
Don't worry, Mrs. Jackson. Everything will be fine.
What did Mrs. Jackson want?
She just wanted to see if I was all right.
She didn't happen to mention anything about your family, did she?
Yes.
Now, listen, I don't want to get you into a flat, but Vera's been spreading it around to the other screws. She thinks you ought to be moved.
What? Where?
She thinks there's some insanity in your family.
No.
Well, she's got a rotten chick. You know, you should never have lied to her. You know what Vera's like. If she wanted to put you in a padded cell, she'd do so just out of spite.
All right. If you didn't attack Miss Bennett, then who did?
I can't remember, and that's the truth, I swear.
Have you ever suffered from blackouts, Anne? Lapses in time, a few minutes, an hour, And you couldn't remember what happened immediately before? And how do you explain not being able to remember this afternoon's incident? Do you consider yourself a truthful person?
Yes.
All right. Now relax and we'll think back to when you were, say, a teenager. How did you get on at school?
I didn't go to school until I was 14. Then I went to boarding school. I had a tutor until then.
Was your family on the land?
No, they just didn't want me to go to school, that's all.
What about brothers and sisters?
My brother went to school, but I wasn't allowed.
Why not?
I was special.
Special? In what way special? All right, now about your tutor. What did you think of him as a teacher, for instance?
He was always telling me what to do.
And you didn't like that?
He used to lock me in my room for hours if I didn't get everything right.
And what did your parents think of that?
They didn't believe me. So I stopped telling them. But I used to tell Megan. She was the only friend I had. She believed me.
And where's Megan now?
She's dead.
Why did your parents think you were special?
I can't remember. They just did. I can't remember. I can't.
We drag the cover back on and then get the hell out of here. I don't want to attract any attention.
How will you get out?
I'll be able to lift this from inside, don't you worry. And then tell Margot to cover for me and Lizzie until I get back. I'll be back as soon as I can. Come on.
Think you're doing? Why aren't you inside?
It's a funeral.
What?
Now, poor soul, she's dead and gone.
And she got what she deserved. She murdered my Megan and now I've buried her.
That's enough of that.
What's dead is dead.
You'll have to do better than that to convince a jury. You're no more crazy than the rest of them.
How'd they turn out? She's beautiful.
Yeah. Can I have them then? Because they're mine.
No, they're not. Why do you want Megan's photos?
Megan? But that's Elizabeth. Come on, quit fooling around.
Don't you touch them. They're mine.
You give them to me, you silly bitch!
You're not going to take her away from me.
Get me out of your brain and I'm down. I'll kill you if you don't give them to me.
He's going to be very pleased to hear about this, Latham.
Griffin, come with me, please.
I'll say anything you want. Don't punish me, please.
I managed to contact your husband, Anne. He said you only married him to escape your family. Why? Why escape?
I love my family.
And did you love your husband, too?
Yes.
And yet you left him for a younger man. And you had Megan by this man.
She died.
And you thought you were being punished for leaving your husband. You felt guilty. And so you left Megan's father too.
He was always punishing me.
Who was Anne?
He'd locked me in my room for hours.
The last time I was here, you said your tutor used to lock you in your room. For telling lies.
Her parents wouldn't believe me. It was so dark in there. So small. I couldn't breathe.
Your room was dark, small?
Oh, the cupboard. It was the cupboard. I had to stay in there until I did as I was told.
How old were you?
5 or 6. He thought I was alone, but I wasn't. I had Megan to talk to. She didn't care if I didn't do as I was told or I got angry. She was my friend. She understood.
But your parents didn't, though, did they? They thought you were different. They wouldn't let you play with anyone. That made you angry. But you weren't allowed to show that you were angry. Were you, Anne? You had to keep it bottled up, otherwise you'd be punished.
Don't do this, don't do that. Oh, Mummy won't love me unless I'm good.
Do you know why you're in here, Anne?
I didn't do anything.
You demanded money from someone at knife point. Don't you remember?
A family gives me an allowance. I don't need any money.
Yes, but money makes you angry too, doesn't it? It means having a tutor. You wanted to escape your family. You didn't want their money anymore. But you had to get some, somehow.
I'm innocent.
It seems the two things that spark off Anne's other self are a fear of rules and a feeling of rejection. Both represent being locked in that cupboard. But perhaps with treatment, we might be able to bring the two personalities closer together, get some sort of balance. But it'll take time. Come along, Anne. Marjorie Quinn?
Yes?
I'm Jason Scott.
Oh, how do you do, Mr. Scott?
Please, call me Jason. Welcome to the island.
Thank you.
Wally, will you get Miss Quinn's luggage? Take it to a suite, please.
Sure thing, Mr. Scott.
Shouldn't I register or something?
No, that's all been taken care of. As soon as you're ready, I thought we might go to my rooms and juggle a few ideas around on how to make this quest a rival to Miss World.
Mr. Scott, Jason, I have had a very tiring trip, which I took at rather short notice. What I should like to do now is go to my room, shower, change, and relax.
Yes, of course, I understand. But you must realize how important the success of this quest is to me, Miss Quinn.
Yes, I understand what you want. But it has to be attractive to me. We have to discuss terms. We'll talk when I'm ready. Then you'll either agree to those terms or I shall be leaving on the next boat.
It's good to see you again, Marjorie.
I can't get over how great you look. And I thought running a successful business was supposed to aid you.
Ah, well, what it does, you see, is provide you with enough money to look after yourself properly. But never mind all that. I've popped in here to have a quiet word with you about Jason Scott. See, there's nothing like a bit of inside information to help prepare you for a negotiation.
You haven't changed a bit, Marjorie.
Well, neither have men. If you're good-looking, they never expect you to be intelligent.
I know Jason, and as an old friend, I'm telling you, watch yourself. He's a pretty fast-footed customer.
Is he now?
A manipulator, darling. Handle with care and keep one eye on your purse.
Well, well, well.
Be
Been thinking about our situation?
Hmm?
Like a divorce. So why pretend anymore? Well, you're darling, this isn't darling, that's the pecks on the cheek. It's all a bit of a floor show, really, isn't it?
If we have our problems, there's no point in forcing them on other people.
If we have problems.
All right, we have problems. Not all my fault, though.
I'm not saying it is. All I'm saying is, I think it would be better if we stopped trying to convince people that we're Mr. and Mrs. Gordon Hamilton. We haven't been that for years. Well, not properly.
Why now? We're no different now than we have been for years. Why the sudden urge to get a divorce?
It's been coming on for a long time. I guess I'm just tired of trying.
All right. Go ahead. Won't get a fight from me. Look. I'm not about to break up your marriage. The last thing I want to do is cause trouble. I just think we owe it to each other.
How can I without Beryl getting suspicious? So far, she doesn't know you're staying at Woombye. If you found out, it wouldn't take her long to put two and two together.
You're right. I shouldn't be asking.
If I can think of a way, I will.
Well, whatever happens, today was wonderful. I better go. John will be wondering where I've got to.
What's been going on with you and David?
Beryl, I don't know what on earth you're talking about.
Oh, come on. I saw you together.
I'm afraid you've lost me.
Yesterday. Oh, you weren't doing anything. But I saw the way you were together. When you were working at the fence.
Beryl, we were simply working. That's what we're both up here for. I'm sorry if you got the wrong idea.
I know I'm right. I haven't been married to David for all these years, not to know when he's guilty. It was written all over his face last night, and again this morning. He can't even look me in the eye.
It's all news to me.
Rubbish. I know it was a long time ago, but he's always had a thing about you. And you can deny it until the cows come home, but I know what you've both been up to.
All right. It was stupid of me to think you wouldn't realize. What's your next step?
I don't have to take any steps.
Oh, you came here. I would have thought that was a fairly major step.
You are so smug. I knew damn well you'd make sure something happened as soon as I found out you were here.
Oh, dear. So now it's all my fault, is it? Well, what about David? What do you think he feels?
Oh, I know. I don't have a hope of trying to fight you here. But he'll be back home again in 2 weeks. We'll see how much hold you have over him then.
Bet you'll be glad to get back to your own bed. It's the thing I enjoy most about going home. Oh, I'm getting quite attached to the one here. Nothing quite like a good old brass bedstead.
And you're welcome to it as long as you like.
Rosie?
You can't push Mrs. Armstrong out.
We are having a private discussion.
You're not the lady of the house anymore.
Get out. I'm very sorry. I don't quite know what made Rosie talk like that. Oh, I've got a fair idea. If the local gossip's anything like what's doing the rounds in Sydney, might be a bad idea if you did pack your bags and leave. Everyone's talking about you and Gordon.
Oh? And what are they saying?
You're on the affair of the month list. I think it'd be best for everybody concerned if you win. Mind you, I do have a stake in suggesting it. It's not easy for Gordon and I to undo the problems we've had. Having a third person around just makes it all the harder.
Perhaps.
Though Gordon has asked me to stay.
Oh, fine for Gordon, but what about my feelings?
I don't see why it should worry you. After all, I was the one that pushed him into seeing you again.
I'm sure.
I'm not in the habit of lying, and if Gordon wants me here, I'm staying.
Only one conclusion I can draw from that. Gossips are right. Your own husband hasn't been dead a month, and you're down here trying to get your hands on mine. I think it's time I was frank. I don't like you. I never have. A most sensible thing for you to do would be to pack your bags and leave. All you can do here is get in the way. Hope that's clear enough for you.
What do you reckon you're doing?
Well, I decided it was ridiculous not being at my own children's 21st.
Does John know about it?
Thought I'd surprise him.
Look, I told you yesterday, Pat. I don't want you around my family.
Well, what about what I want, David? They're my children. This is a big day in their lives, and I would like to be there.
Tough! You're not getting in, Pat. So just leave.
I am probably the one person who has a perfect right to be there. I am their mother.
And I'm their father.
That's what you think. I was pregnant when I met you. They're not your children. Oh, that'd make a nice little birthday present, wouldn't it?
You put your face through that door, and I'll flatten you.
You may not know much about me, but I've been able to find out quite a lot about you.
Have you?
It seems we have mutual friends. And I like what I've learned. Apparently, you're the sort of woman who's used to getting what she wants. I approve of that.
Good.
I'm glad Stephen married again.
So am I.
I'm not as young as I was. My heart plays up on the odd occasion.
Oh, I'm sure you're a long way off old age.
We're both intelligent women. Don't patronize me.
I'm sorry.
The fact is, I've reached the time of life when I want to tidy up my affairs. And there's something I dearly love to see.
Yes?
It's always bothered me that I have no grandson. I mean, from Stephen. No one to carry on the Morell name.
Well, I don't really think we didn't plan on...
My dear, you're still a young woman. Your childbearing days are far from over. And nothing would make me happier than for you and Stephen to present me with a grandson. I'm sure you'd be glad to indulge an old woman's whim. I thought I'd hold fire on the signature while you think about it. Shall we say 3 days? I'll be in the living room if you want to talk about it.
This is outrageous.
What's she done?
She's reworded everything. It all depends on us having a son.
You're kidding.
Come on. Something we would have talked about, will or no will.
I can't have any more children. Medical impossibility. I'm sorry.
Don't be sorry. I just didn't know, that's all.
Not upset?
I married you because I love you. Having children is not the be-all and end-all of our relationship.
Oh, it is to your mother. She's in for a big disappointment when she finds out the facts.
I can't risk that. She'd cut us off without a cent.
We just have to bluff our way through. Nothing's signed yet. The will isn't legal.
She could fix that in about 2 seconds.
We shall have to play for time. After all, she does have a weak heart.
Darling, she is my mother.
Well, she can't expect love and affection when she carries on like a female version of Henry VIII. You are entitled to something.
Can't she just accept it?
No, I can't.
I don't see why not. After all, you agreed to be cut off from Dee completely, that we have nothing more to do with her or her money. So why are you so upset about it?
Because the old car shouldn't be allowed to get away with it, that's why. How dare she leave all that money to Beryl Palmer and Margaret? God.
You know the only reason she did it was to create trouble with us. Well, it seems as if you're proving her right.
Well, I don't care. Darling, come with me to the Palmers. We can talk Beryl into signing that money over to you. She'll be feeling guilty. I know she will.
For heaven's sake, if Dee wanted Beryl Palmer to have it, let her have it. Forget the money.
No, I'm damned if I will. All that money should be yours, Steve, and every solitary cent. Aren't you going to fight for what's yours?
I've said what I think, Patricia. I'm not going to change my mind. Where the hell do you think you're going?
Out.
Patricia.
To the Palmers. You may be too weak to fight, but I'm not. I know you both realize how difficult it is for me to come here.
Yes, it must be awful.
Still, I haven't come to talk about myself or to ask any favors. That'd be pretty ludicrous after all the things that have happened over the last few years.
Yeah, I reckon.
But I feel I can talk to you about Stephen. I think you know, Beryl, that Stephen's a very straightforward sort of man. Actually, he didn't approve of my coming here. But I felt that you'd understand that he is one of three people who really should have been beneficiaries. As much as we don't see eye to eye, I felt that Barbara should have had her share
as
well.
Why don't you come straight out with it, Patricia? You're here to ask me to hand back the money, right?
Correct.
Well, I do agree with you on one thing. Stephen should certainly have got his share. And if he'd have asked me himself, I'd have been more than happy to hand the money over. However, Barbara phoned me about half an hour ago to warn me you're on your way. And she told me he's not interested in the money. So I can only assume you're after it for yourself. And if that's the case, you may as well leave right now because you're not going to get a brass razoo from me.
Oh, you think you're very clever, don't you? Well, I wouldn't get too used to the idea of being rich. You may never see the money by the time I've taken you through court.
I think you've said enough, Pat. It's time you left.
Oh, you can take that simpering Miss Goody Two Shoes look off your face. We all know the way you worked it. Oh, yes, you know what I'm talking about. Groveling and fussing over Dee, making sure you'd be thought of when the time came. Oh, you're as bad as the rest of them. It's just a pity you haven't got the taste to know how to spend the money properly. What about me?
Sorry?
I said, what about me? You have put me through the most unbelievable hell for that woman. And if she'd had a precious grandson, everything would have been fine. We would have had the money and had the house, and I wouldn't have had to have gone through all that humiliation. She humiliated me. Oh, you were fine. I was the one that she was trying to get at. How could you let me go through all that? Well, you just could have stopped it like that.
Well, what would have happened to Andrew if I had? Dee would have taken over his life.
Well, so what? I'm your wife. I'm supposed to take priority over everyone.
Telling Dee about Andrew would have meant involving a completely innocent person.
And what the hell was I when I married you? I didn't have any choice. I was dragged into the whole mess before I knew what was going on.
Would it have made any difference?
Not before today. But now, I've gone through hell for you. Now, I'm sorry if that sounds melodramatic, but it's true. I put up with all of that because I loved you. But I can't love somebody who treats me like that. When I married you, I admired you. I thought you were strong. What kind of a fool does that make me?
Sure, why?
I'm coming with you.
help if I said I was sorry?
No. I'm going back to Sydney.
Look, I really
think... Matt Kennedy's giving me a lift.
Hardly seems fair involving a stranger in it.
Seems to be your favourite line at the moment.
All right. I'll see you in a few days. I'll give you time to calm down.
I'm not going to calm down. I don't think you understand. When you come back to Sydney, we'll have to sort out some new living arrangements. I'm leaving you. You rushing round here to rub my face in the latest disaster. I don't know why you bother.
I'm bothering because it's important to me. I want to see you get what you deserve, not just hear about it.
Oh, Margaret, can't we behave like adults for a change? Look, I'm not proud of what happened with you and Martin, but I think I was a little disturbed at the time. The trouble is, you are much worse.
I know exactly what I'm doing.
Oh, yes. Trying to run me down, electrocute me with a stereo. Just turning up here, that is not normal behavior. I admit that I started this whole thing. But we were close once. I screwed that up, I know. But I don't think it's too late. Pipe dream, maybe, but I think we can be sisters again. You really are scared, aren't you?
You bet it's a pipe dream.
Oh, go on, get out. I can't be bothered with you.
I'm sure. Well, it must be hard. No husband. No home. Booted out by your boyfriend. You're going to have a rough time if you don't find yourself another meal ticket. And they don't grow on trees at your age.
You know, I probably feel stronger now than I have done at any time during my life. Oh, I'm upset about Stephen, but I'll get over it. There's only one thing I really regret. You. Prison's turned you... I don't know, but it's sad. You're going to be very sick if you go on like this. And very lonely.
I'll have Stephen. I'll manage.
The pathetic thing is that you really believe that. You're not going to have anybody. And if you were honest with yourself, you'd realize it.
Are you joining someone in Rio?
No, I'm leaving somebody in Australia.
The end of a love affair. A new start in a new city. And a new friend to show it to you.
I don't believe it.
I'm Pam. I would have checked you out earlier, but I've been unavailable. Staring's rude, love. Didn't your mother ever tell you?
Oh, I'm sorry. It's just that you look like someone.
Be a bit worried if I didn't.
I mean, like someone I used to know, how she used to look. I'm not making any sense, am I?
I'm glad you said that. I was beginning to think I'd been in here too long.
But you really do. It's like seeing a ghost. You're the living image of her.
This woman's a friend of yours. Maybe she could come and change places with me.
Oh, no, she couldn't. Oh, that's what I meant. She used to look like you, but she doesn't anymore.
I was joking. I've stuck it out here for 10 years. I'd be mad to try a break now.
Well, are you feeling ready to face the world?
I'm ready. It's the world I'm worried about.
Oh?
I'm heading straight for the top, Beryl. Won't be long. I'll have that house in Vaucluse. Limo in the garage. Yacht on the harbour.
Now, that sounds like Patricia.
Well, it's all going to be legal, too. I'm not stealing another cent. I'm going to make it. If people are nice to me, I'll be nice to them.
What if they're not?
Well, I'll just have to be nasty.
What the hell do you think you're doing? You must be the new tenant. I hope you're settling in, all right?
You haven't answered my question.
I simply took the precaution of inspecting your belongings.
Inspecting? What are you, the local customs officer?
I happen to own the place.
Nothing's been taken. I was worried about the safety of the other tenants, that's all. All your tenants get this kind of treatment, I suppose? No, only those who have come out of jail. Yes, get out. Take your hands off me, lady. You are in no position to tell me what to do now. Get out! In the meantime, I thought we could have a chat.
Never give up, do you?
No. Not until you give me a chance to set the record straight on that stupid book. Save it. I'm not interested. I'm not your friend. I don't want to be your friend. I don't even like you. And if you don't stop hanging around me like a bad smell, I'm going to punch your head in. Fine. Fine, you do what you want. But there's something you should know first. It might explain why I've been hanging around like a bad smell, as you so delicately put it. You happen to be my sister.
There's more to it. I've never met anyone like him before. He makes me feel alive.
An affair that will have deadly repercussions. I want to take you to bed.
There is nothing wrong with my marriage. But if there was, then I would suggest to you that you put it right.
What a catch, eh? Quite a difference from his usual run-of-the-mill slut.
You...
You are my wife, Elaine. And if you think you're going to ruin my career or drag my name through the mud because of some grubby little affair with a low-class commie mouthpiece, then you're very much mistaken.
An affair that will not be tolerated by any member of the family.
Thou shall not get caught. He knew about us, and he made love to me, and I let him. He wanted me to believe that we still had a chance. He almost convinced me.
Leave him.
I feel used.
Stay in bed. That's what you really need.
This is Shauna. My daughter.
I think it's time we left for the train.
Yeah, it doesn't look like Harry's going to come and see me off.
John? Mum? Would you give us a minute?
Yes, of course.
I finished reading your book. Don sort of pressed me to. And I realised I was wrong.
Really?
Well, I didn't know how hard you had to struggle. I mean, to put me through school, then uni.
I wanted you to have a good education, for my sake as well as yours.
Yeah, but I didn't know how bad things were with Dad.
No. Hang on a tick. You're going from stem to stern here. Look, Harry, I won't lie to you. Your father was useless at business, but he had a good heart.
Yeah, but he was a drunk, Mum.
Yes, he was. But he was also the kindest, most gentle man that I've ever known. Frank thought life was a party. Problem is, he forgot that someone had to pay in the end, and that was usually me. But he just thought life was so much fun. He made it so much fun. I tell you what, I don't regret a minute I spent with that man. And if I had the chance to do it all over again, I'd grab it.
You would?
Yeah. Now, we might have had a bit of a run-in about my book, but that's going to be nothing to the Barney we'll have if you don't stop thinking bad things about your dad. Is that clear?
Crystal.